Let the great God of their father be the great God of their children. Let the great God of my father be the great God of my children still. Thank you.
I know we got a few folks still coming in. It's good to see everyone as we gather around the good news of what God has done for the world. We get to gather around the good news of what God has specifically done through Jesus. And so as we start, we've got a special guest with us this morning, Jacob, who's typically up here singing. He and his wife are on vacation. I think they attempted, or at least Jacob attempted, to make it to the summit of Mount Katahdin, and they failed. They will blame it on the weather, but it wasn't the weather. Okay? I'm just kidding. So hopefully they're still having a good vacation, and we have Austin here with us to lead us in music, and so we're thankful for you being here, Austin. And so I'm going to say a short prayer and then invite you to stand, and we will sing this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you. And we thank you for your love and grace and mercy. We thank you that no matter what kind of week all of us have had, good, the bad, the ugly, in this space we gather around the good news of what you have done for us as individuals and the good news of what you have done for the world. And I pray that all those who are filled with worry and anxiety would in this moment find rest in you. I pray that all those in our church family and in our community who are in desperate need of healing, whether it be spiritually or emotionally, would find it through Jesus. I pray for all those who are seeking, who aren't sure what they think about God or the Bible or Jesus. I pray that you would reveal your truth to them in this moment. And I thank you that for all of us who have this week failed, there's good news for us. I pray that you would be honored, that you would be glorified, and that you would move and empower us to help people find and follow Jesus, to be transformed by God's word and spirit and people, to join the mission of Jesus. We pray these things in your name. Amen. Amen. I want to invite you to sing. We're going to sing a couple of songs this morning to start off.
Thank you.
may be seated. Would like to take this time to invite our kids at the kids' church. All of you guys that would like to take part in that, you are dismissed for that. Actually, before you dismiss, let me say a quick prayer over you guys. Okay, I see you guys. Dear Lord, we thank you so much for these little ones, and we pray that as they go, they would not only have fun, but Lord, they would have a good foundation of theological truth laid so that they could come to know and love and trust you and follow you all of their days, that you would raise up these young boys and young girls to be used by you to make a great difference for your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. And so really just a few things to make you aware of before we continue on with our worship gathering. The first thing is, most of you know that we are in the process starting the process of changing our church name, primarily because there's a lot of confusion on what our church name is, and a lot of people get us confused with Portland First Baptist Church, and so we are in that process. And today is your last day to, if you have a name suggestion, to write that down. There are note cards in the back, and to put it in the drop box where people put their connect cards and tithes and offerings. And we've had one, thank you all. We've had lots of name suggestions. And so that's going to be very, very helpful. And so after that, we've got a group of folks, some newer folks to the church, lifetime members. We're going to come together and kind of narrow those names down to three or four. And then what we're going to do is pass out a church-wide survey. And so we'll pass that survey out, and we'll also pass that survey out to people in our community and neighborhoods, people that don't go to church. And so from those results, we will put forward a name for our church members to vote on. So that's coming, and that's why. So thank you for all of your help and prayer in this. The next thing is, one of the things you hear almost weekly is that we exist to make disciples of Jesus. Jesus tells us to go forth and make disciples of all nations, right? So to help people find and follow Jesus, to be transformed by Jesus and join the mission of Jesus. That is why we exist. And one of my prayers is that we would take that so seriously, that we would be making disciples to the utmost degree, that our church would be this growing, healthy, vibrant body, that we would also be able to, because of where we've been and where God has us going, plug into other and help other churches, specifically in northern New England, who are dying and need leadership and resources and help, that we would be able to go and do that. And for us to do that, it takes us getting this right, that we would be a people who are growing with God. We're growing in relationships with other. We're serving God with purpose and on purpose, understanding why God created us, where we're engaging our world, where we live, our neighbors, our families, our communities, our neighborhoods, with the good news of Jesus. And so one of the things we do is we gather here weekly to be affirmed and reaffirmed of the gospel, because we all need the gospel daily, where we corporately gather, we confess our sins, we're assured of the gospel, and we learn to apply our lives to the Bible together. And then also, we want to grow in relationships with each other. And so September 5th, our small group semester is happening. And we've got a lot of you guys have already signed up in the back. And so this is a time to gather around with other believers and grow in relationships. We're really building one another up with prayer and encouragement. So there's two men's groups. There's two women's groups. There's a group for college age, young adults. And so if you're not signed up yet, please sign up for that. And I'm really excited about what God is doing and where God wants to take our church. And it starts with making disciples. And part of making disciples is understanding that we're all on a journey of being conformed to the likeness of Christ, to be used by Jesus for his glory. And so now we will continue on with our worship gathering. And we will do what we do weekly. We will declare our dependence on God. We will declare that we all, no matter where we are in life, new believers, lifelong followers of Jesus, we all fail. We all fail at being good parents and grandparents. We all fail at being good bosses and employees. We all fail at being good neighbors. We all fail when we are judgmental. We all fail in looking to the hopes of this world. And yet Jesus is for us. And so I want to invite you to confess with me these words. The words will be behind me on the screen. Merciful God, forgive us for our sins. We seek to be satisfied with the things of this world. We place our hope in the things of this world. Forgive us for looking to created things for joy and fulfillment. Help us to trust in your goodness. Help us to prioritize your kingdom and not our own. Have mercy on us. See, all of us are continually in need of God's love and grace and mercy. We all need God's Spirit to empower us to follow Jesus well. And even though we fail often and we fail regularly, Jesus' life and death and resurrection is better. Jesus' life and death and resurrection is greater. And so, brothers and sisters, and all those who place their faith in the work of Jesus, you are eternally and immeasurably forgiven in Christ. So I want to invite you to respond to the assurance we have of the gospel by standing and singing this next song with me.
You are the one.
Austin for leading us in those wonderful songs. So there's a story that some of you may have heard before about an old miser who knew he was about to die, and this old miser was on his deathbed, and he didn't want all of his family and all of his friends to get what was his. And so he did what any reasonable old miser would do on his deathbed. He called together three of his closest friends. He called together a preacher, he called together a doctor, and he called together a lawyer. And he made them promise. I'm going to divide $1 million between the three of you. And what you have to do, so here are these three suitcases. What you have to do is right before they close the casket, I need all of these suitcases in my casket so I can be buried with at least $1 million of my dollars. And the three men agreed to do so for their friend, this greedy sort of person. And they do it. And on their way to the wake of their dearly departed friend, they're having a conversation. And the preacher, almost with tears in his eyes, starts to confess his sins to these other two men. And he says, look, I have to confess. The church where I'm a pastor, we really need some things. The building is just, it's failing, it's falling. And so I kept 10% of the money to go toward these facility renovations. And then the doctor, spurred on by the pastor's honesty, said, look, I've got to confess too. I kept 30% of the money that was in the suitcase because, you know, we're doing this groundbreaking research that will cure cancer, and we really needed these funds, and so I took 30%. And then the lawyer looked at both of them, full of disgrace, full of now this kind of consternation and animosity, so shocked and surprised that his two friends would do this. And he says, I'm appalled. I wrote a personal check for 100% of the amount and threw it in the casket on my way home. You know, the reality is, what you have now is temporal at best. What you have now will not last. What you have now will eventually be gone. What you have now is short. And what we're all confronted with really is the fact that we all are tempted. We all struggle with materialism and placing our hopes and our dreams in things and stuff and bank accounts and money and degrees and family and homes. We're all confronted with materialism daily, and it draws and it pulls our hearts to cause us to hope in things that do not last. And this morning we're continuing on with the conversation we started now months ago, called The Way of Jesus, where we're looking at this beautiful teaching in the Bible where Jesus goes up onto this mountain in the Gospel of Matthew, and he teaches his followers his way. He teaches his followers what it looks like to follow Jesus. He teaches his followers this kind of better way to exist and be and live and breathe and just experience humanity. And just a reminder, this Sermon on the Mount, as it's commonly referred to, is not a live this way, do these things, check these boxes, and if you do so well and right and good, then God will love you. If you do so well and right and good, then you can earn God's favor. That's not what this teaching is. This teaching really is how to live as we follow Jesus. What does it look like as we place our faith in Jesus and belong to his kingdom now, not because of anything we could ever do, but because God did all of the work through Jesus? What does it look like to live and follow him? And this morning we're confronted with Jesus' understanding and Jesus' better way to deal with materialism, to think about materialism. which, as many of you have guessed, means we are probably, and probably means we are, talking about money today. And so before we read the passage and get into the text, I know that money in general is awkward to talk about. And I know that money in general is even more awkward to talk about in church. So one, I get it. And I want to give you two stipulations. And I give these two stipulations anytime we talk about money. Because the reality is, as we go through the Bible talks about money, which means we have to as well. And so the first stipulation as we talk about money is this. I will never ask you to do anything that I personally and my family is not doing, ever. Right? So I will not ask you to give when I'm not giving. I will not ask you to set aside a percentage of your money to give to the church or whatever if we're not doing that. Anything I ask you, I am personally doing, my family is personally doing. The second thing is this, because I know the way a lot of people can think, I do not get paid on commission, okay? And so after this morning, if you know everybody's just convicted and we give tons of money, I'm not getting a raise this week, okay? I'm not a used car salesman. So just to get those two things out of the way, because money can be awkward, and I know we all kind of think these certain things. And so those are the two. I will not ask you to do something I'm not doing, and I do not get paid on commission. My salary will not change this week if our giving goes up, okay? So now with that, let's take a brief moment to pray, and then we'll get into God's Word. Heavenly Father, we come to you. And right now, specifically, Lord, we thank you for your Word. We thank you that as we read it, we can trust that by the power of your Spirit, you are speaking to us. And I pray that we would have ears to hear and hearts to receive your truth. That we would come under the teachings found in the Bible, knowing that it is your way, that it is the better way. That when we trust in you and we follow you, we can actually find real fulfillment and satisfaction and joy, even when our circumstances dictate otherwise. And I pray that we would gladly and sincerely come under your Word in every area of our lives, that there would be no part of our heart that we keep from you, but that we would willingly, now in this moment, come to hear and be shaped and molded and conformed into the image and likeness of your Holy Son, Jesus. And in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. So I'm going to now read the text. And so if you're kind of newer to our church family, I'm going to read the passage, and then afterwards I'm going to say, this is the word of the Lord. And then we corporately say, thanks be to God. This is just kind of a way for us to be reminded that what we are reading is not just another good story. It's not just a teaching from another guru. We are thankful that we have God's word and that it is true and for us. And so Matthew chapter 6 is where we will be this morning. Matthew chapter 6. And I'm going to start reading in verse 19 and finish reading in verse 24. And Jesus said this, do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The eye is the lamp of the body. So if your eye is healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light in you is darkness, how great is the darkness? No one can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. This is the word of the Lord. So Jesus, remember, he's going through, he started with these kind of the Beatitudes, these attitudes of what it looks like to belong to God's kingdom. And then he moves into this kind of, this is the Old Testament and it points to me and I fulfill everything in the Old Testament, in the law. And then he tells us kind of how the religious leaders at the time understood the law and righteousness and how they missed the heart of the Old Testament, and he points us to the heart of God in it. And then now, last week and this week, he's really pointing us to these practical implications of how God's righteousness ought to be lived and look like in the lives of his followers. And so now we're in these real practical implications of the gospel in our lives, and he's bringing it down to money. Last week he talked about spiritual disciplines, prayer and fasting and giving. And now we're moving to Jesus' understanding of money. And he says this, "Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth." So, Jesus tells us not to invest all of our resources to accrue treasure on earth. Why would Jesus tell us not to do that? He then goes on and answers the question, where moth and rust destroy. And so when Jesus is speaking, first century antiquity, moth and rust were two pretty significant things, right? They didn't have what we have in modern, well, I would say air conditioning, window units. Can I just pause for a second? You know, people have asked, because we're from Alabama, 32 years I lived in Alabama, and people were asking, well, how was winter? People here, how's the cold? How's that going? I was like, really, that's not as bad as it being hot outside and not being able to make it cold inside, right? But anyway, we had things like refrigerators and things that can guard against rust and moth. We had things like paint. And so in antiquity, definitely, and then he goes on to say, you know, where thieves break in and steal, you're talking about clay homes, where it would have been very easy. You acquire your wealth and whatever it is, rubies, cash, salt, for a thief to break in and take all of these things where moth and rust can genuinely destroy all of your possessions. And he's pointing to the fact that when you invest all of your resources, time, money, heart, affections, gifts, talents to acquire and accrue stuff, that stuff will not last. And in antiquity specifically, that stuff might not last your lifetime. And so maybe it's not as bad for us because we have things like IRAs and the stock market and all of these things where we can invest stuff for it to grow in the future. But the reality is true for us. If we spend all of our time and our energy and our thoughts and our resources that God has given us to acquire more stuff, it is temporal at best. It will not last. And so Jesus says, do not store up treasures on earth. Now, before we really get into this, the Bible is not against wealth. The Bible is not against making a profit. One of my former bosses, every morning we would start, he was one of the godliest men I knew, and he would quote a passage every morning. Let us go into town and, Lord willing, make a profit. The Bible is not against making money. The Bible is not against saving. God used the wise stewarding of Joseph in the Old Testament to save people, right? To have stuff away for a rainy day, or in his case, a famine. Like, save, there's wisdom in saving. We're supposed to save. There's nothing against wealth or earning money and putting money away for the future or for your kids' college or whatever. The Bible is not against those things, okay? But the Bible is against our treasure being in these good things, where we place our hopes for fulfillment and satisfaction in these things that will not last, that will not be forever. Now, the word treasures in this context does not mean just money. It's an inclusive term, and it goes beyond the idea of just money or cash. Money is obviously included, But Jesus is talking about getting our satisfaction from things that belong to this world alone. Getting our satisfaction from things that only belong to the material world at large. And so yes, a treasure means more than money. But the reality is, if you really want to know what you treasure, and maybe that treasure is a career, maybe that treasure is a house, maybe that treasure is a family, maybe that treasure are good things that we should value and invest in. But when those good things are our hope to be fully satisfied, to find fulfillment in its most deepest sense, you see, those things will always fail. Those things will always fall short because those things were not created to be our end all. You see, that's what God, we were created to enjoy God and glorify Him forever. And so obviously a treasure means more than money, but the reality is if you want to know where your treasure is, follow the money and you'll know. Because you invest what you value and you value what you invest in. And so really, simply, just this verse before we move on into the rest of the text, I want you to understand this. And here's what we all have to guard against. Don't let money and all that comes with it be an idol. Don't let money and all that comes with it become an idol. So what is an idol? So the New City Catechism, it's a question and answer. It's what we use with our sons. And this is a great answer. This is idolatry. It's trusting in created things rather than the Creator for our hope and happiness, significance and security. And so we've got to guard against money becoming this thing that is an idol that we put our hope and trust in. Because you really can't take any of it with you. Right? The miser in his grave with not quite all of his fortune was not fulfilled in any way with having it in his coffin with him. So what should we do? Jesus goes on in verse 20. And he says this, "But instead, lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven." So lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. So instead of just investing in the temporal, invest in the eternal. Like there is this corporeal reality, this reality that transcends material things. There is this reality that is eternal. And Jesus just simply uses the word heaven. Invest in these things. Why? Because moth and rust cannot destroy. Thieves cannot break in and steal. So store up treasures in heaven. This is what Jesus tells us. And then he goes on in verse 21. "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." Now that one verse is fascinating if you read it slowly. Where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Now it's important for you to understand that heart in this context, and when Jesus said the word heart, he meant more than kind of how we think about the term heart, of like passions and affection, like I love ice cream with all my heart. That's not what Jesus is getting at. It's more than that. See, heart really is it's the understanding of who we are. It's our inner person. It's the kind of core of our total being. And Jesus says, this core of your total being, where is it? Well, it's where your treasure is. Now, most of us probably would have corrected Jesus. We would have said, no, Jesus, you're wrong. We would have said, your treasure is, or your heart is, where your treasure is. Where your treasure is, your heart will be. We tend to think in terms of where our heart is, there our treasure will be. Our treasures and our resources and our money, they follow our heart. They follow the core of our inner being. And Jesus says the opposite. Jesus says where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Jesus says your heart follows your money, essentially, every time. Your heart always follows your treasure. You see, what you invest your time and money into, that's where your heart will be. I mean, think about it. So my dad, I grew up playing ice hockey. My dad grew up in a very fundamentalist Pentecostal church in the South and was not allowed to play any kind of sport growing up because that was worldly. That's what the pagans do. And so when my dad had kids, like he was determined, and we didn't have a lot of money, but he was determined that my sister and I, we would do whatever we wanted to in the realm of sports. And I grew up playing ice hockey. I loved it. And I ended up playing travel hockey. And years later, I found out that that was really a big strain on my family. And talking to my dad about it, so he so valued what he missed out in life on. He was willing to make sacrifices, to invest in me getting to play travel hockey. And his heart, very really, it followed that investment. Our teammates called him the hardcore hockey dad. He was at every practice, every game, before, after. He was always encouraging everyone. He knew everyone's name. Why? Because he was invested. He made significant sacrifices to let me be on this team. He was invested, and his heart followed. And the same is true with anything we do. The things we invest in, our heart follows every time. It's not the opposite. Jesus absolutely knows what he's talking about. So your heart always follows your treasure. And then Jesus goes on to say, the eye is the lamp of the body. So if your eye is healthy, your whole body will be full of light. Okay, now Jesus, what in the world are you talking about? Like you went from money and our heart following our treasure, and now we're talking about our eyes. I'm lost. But this is what he's saying. So your eye is the lamp of your body. If it's healthy, your body will be healthy. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. See, here's the way we view material things. What we view, the lenses by which we view reality. The way we view material things affects the health of our heart. How we see the world affects the health of our heart. And remember, this whole series, Jesus is concerned with our hearts. Our actions will follow our heart. Our heart will follow our treasures. The way we view material things absolutely affects the health of our heart. You see, when we see the world through the lenses of materialism, our hearts will be shallow and easily conquered. And it will never find rest and security. And then Jesus goes on to say this in verse 24, no one can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. God cannot be your king. And for us, in a very prosperous culture of America, it can easily happen when we least expect it. Where we start looking to treasure and money and resources to find fulfillment and satisfaction. And when we view materialism as this kind of way to attain fulfillment and satisfaction, our hearts will not reach the health that God has for them. We have to decide if we will serve the God of this world or Jesus. And again, making money is good. Saving is good. Being wise with the resources which God has given us is good. But when those good things become more than good things, our hearts are in danger. And so what are we to do? How do we guard against idolatry? How do we guard against materialism? How do we guard against letting resources and money and things become the gods of our hearts? And so here's what I think. This is my opinion. When we look at the totality of the Bible and we see what the Bible teaches on generosity and how we are to live with our resources, here is my opinion on how we do that. It's this. Give to the mission of Jesus regularly and consistently. The giving to the mission of Jesus regularly and consistently would be just a part of your rhythm of life. It would be part of the rhythm of your wallet or Venmo or checking account, or however it is that you do money. That giving to the mission of Jesus regularly and consistently would just be part of how you worship, would be part of how you follow Jesus as we guard against materialism, as we guard against the gods of this world being the gods of our heart. And so by doing this, I do things regarding I do think we are guarding our hearts against greed and idolatry. And two, it's by tangibly confessing that what we have really is not ours. We are stewards of what the Lord has given us for this brief moment in eternal history that we are here. You know, 1 Chronicles 29:14 says this, "But who am I, and what is my people, that we should be able thus to offer willingly? For all things come from you, and of your own have we given you." What we have, like, one of the scariest things to people that do not follow Jesus is this teaching. Like, when I talk to one of my friends who's thoroughly agnostic, and we talk about what it means to follow Jesus, and I'm like, oh no, as a believer, I willingly declare that, like, the money I have isn't mine. No, I'm not following Jesus. And we've had these kind of conversations. No, I don't like that. I work hard. I've invested a lot in school to attain stuff. And so you're really okay with saying that, Zach? Absolutely. What I have is not mine. It belongs to the Lord. And that means, and so I, as a way to tangibly confess that, is I give regularly and consistently to the mission of Jesus through my local church. And so, at the practical level, throughout the history of the church, a lot of people, to do this, to build it into their rhythm, have given the first 10% of their income to the mission of Jesus, right? And so this is an idea that people pull out of the Old Testament. When the term tithe is used, it typically means the first 10%. And I know that some of you in here are like, look, I want to get there. But I'm not there yet. I've got to get things in order. I want to follow Jesus well. And if you can't give 10%, pick a number for right now, in this season where you are, and start giving regularly and consistently to the mission of Jesus. And then as you get things in order, strive to move forward with that every year. And we're going to guard against greed. We're going to guard against materialism. We're going to worship the way Jesus wants us to worship, not only with being nice to people, and not only with being generous to people, but literally with our money. And when we become invested in the mission of Jesus, guess where our hearts will follow? Hey, saying that we exist to make disciples of Jesus will be more than just a good saying we get from the Bible. When we are invested in it, when we are invested in the mission of Jesus, I'm going to be more willing and ready to sacrifice my preferences, my time, my gifts, my talents, to move this mission forward. And this is where I believe Jesus wants our hearts to be, invested in his mission, to help people find and follow Jesus, to be transformed by God's Spirit, God's Word, and God's people, to join the mission of Jesus, which is helping people find. You know, there's this, you know, circular thing that's going to happen. And I want all of us to be invested in that. And so I'm going to close in prayer and invite Austin to come and lead us in one last song. And so the challenge is really simply this: if you are not giving regularly and consistently, start now. And maybe you're like, look, I don't make a whole lot of money. It's not about how much money you make. It's about where your heart is, and it's about leading your heart with your money. But I don't make a lot of money. Those of you that come to our annual business meetings know I'm not an overly wealthy, I'm not an almost wealthy man, right? And if I can do it, so can you. It's not about how much. It's about worshiping and being obedient to the mission of Jesus. And so just start small and be committed to working your way up. I promise God will meet your needs and God will provide. I promise you will be glad you did it. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you. We thank you for your love and grace and mercy. We thank you that you care about our hearts. And in doing so, you actually care about our money. And I pray that we as a family, a church family with friends here, that we would understand that we are stewards of what you give us. And that we would draw a line in the sand this morning and say, I will not worship the gods of this world. But instead, I will worship Jesus. And whatever that looks like, I'm okay with it. That you would be honored in our attitudes. That you would be honored in how well we love our neighbors. And that you would be honored in the rhythm of our money. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So I do want to invite you to stand and we'll sing one last song this morning. God is generous and He loves us generously. And so I want to invite you to say this creed we say weekly. As we leave where we are ready and willing to be generous with not only our money but our time and our talents to make a difference in this world for Jesus. I invite you to say these words with me. We will worship God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit with our time, talents, and resources. What we have is yours and for your glory. Hey, I pray that the Lord would go before you this week, that His grace would be with you, and that we would see you next time. God be with you.